Like to call to order the special meeting of the mayor and city council to discuss the resolution 2016-28 referendum election. And I'd like Councilman Joe Vigliotti to lead us in the pledge.
That's great.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everyone. Again, the stated purpose of this meeting is to address the wording on the referendum election ballot and to come up with a consensus and a language we can insert on the ballot. Before we begin our discussion, though, I'd like to just note that Mayor Pro Tem Diane Foster's not with us this evening. I'll read a statement that she sent me through the email. I'm out of town attending the conference. I'm out of town attending a conference relevant to my duties as chair of the Board of Trustees to the Carroll Community College. I regret that I cannot be here to take part in the discussion and the decision on the language to be included on the referendum for November 15th election. The only edit to the language that I would like to point out is the no vote section. Remove the word and the sentence should read, "No, I vote against the charter amendment, which will prohibit the provisions for removal of elected officials." As I previously stated in the motion, it's imperative that the council get this referendum process done as soon as possible so that the council can focus on other important city business. And that's submitted by Diane Foster, Mayor Pro Tem. Now, council, what comments do we have? Or maybe, Jay, you'd like to kick it off.
Okay, I will be happy to, Mr. Mayor. What you have and the format that we have tonight, you can see it's up on the board, which is an unusual step for us. But the resolution 2016-28 with the referendum election was in a draft format in your last package. And all the verbiage that you see up there that starts with whereas has been in your package and hasn't changed. At your last meeting, a motion was made and passed that you wanted to have a special election. And I gave a presentation at that time that talked to you about how you had to schedule the special election due to the presidential election and how we work in concert with the Carroll County Board of Elections. And at that point in time, the only opportunity to have a special election, if you were going to have it as soon as possible, would be on November 15th, 2016. And so you agreed on that portion of it, but I informed you at that time that you weren't passing the resolution. You were simply saying to the staff and the Board of Elections, yes, we want to have a special election. Figure out how we can comply with the terms of the state law to make that happen. The terms of the state law require you to pass a resolution between 4 and 6 weeks prior to that time, and that's why you're having your special meeting tonight. The big focus then tonight is the new language. It's in italics. It's on the right-hand panel there under number 2. Anything in italics starting with a yes vote all the way through the bottom of that page is something that was added to that and was stated was going to be added. It was in your agenda package for your discussion, review, and discussion tonight. The exact language that is going to go on the ballot for the ballot question has to be included in that section. That's the draft that the staff has come up with of what do you think it should be. And tonight, you need to make what you want it to be. Eventually, you're going to need to pass a motion to do that. The reason we have this set up is that we don't want any hindrance in doing that. So Claire is going to come out there. If you need to have the words changed, she'll make the changes as we go. So that once you have a version that you agree on, we will actually print it. She'll go downstairs, get it off the printer. You'll have it in front of you to make sure that's the exact language you want. And then you can make your motions and vote and go from there. So that's where we are. About the language that the staff has come up with, the idea of any referendum is to say yes or no, yay or nay. to the citizens when they come in. Do they want this or do they not want this? This follows roughly the format of what you would see on a state election ballot question. There's going to be some on the November 8th election for the state when the state has theirs, and so it follows roughly that. You can make it anything you want it to be. So, if there's no questions, that's where you should focus.
Mr. Mayor, I have a question of staff, attorney, if that's all right.
Don, you want to offer something?
Let me just ask for clarity based on what you just said. About going and making copies so we'd all have something to act on tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So if we make changes to what you suggested, you're going to then bring them up, and then you're suggesting we vote on this tonight.
I'm not suggesting. I mean, you need to adopt this tonight if you want the special election.
Okay, I just want to be clear about that.
So, yes.
And so in order, so we have a final draft.
You will have the exact language. The plan between Clara and I is that you will have the paper copy of what's up there that you've agreed on, and that's what you'll vote on. So
okay,
we're gonna work up here until you guys reach a consensus, then we'll move to paper, and then you'll be set.
Any other council members have any comments or suggestions?
Did you want to go first?
I do. I wanted to suggest a change to it. In the initial introduction of it on for the referendum, where it says a yes vote shall amend the city charter, I personally don't find it confusing, but I think others may accuse it of being a leading introduction. I'd prefer that it read on whether to amend the city charter.
I agree with that. I don't think, can I speak to that?
Can you tell me exactly what you're talking about? I think Clara.
All right, if you strike the words, a yes vote shall.
Higher, right there.
Mm-hmm. A yes vote shall, if you were to strike those, no problem.
And what was the reason for that?
I feel that some may accuse us of being leading by trying to influence people to vote yes because it says a yes vote shall.
No, I think the only way you can do it is pull the cart back.
Did everybody get a copy of that, of what we're looking at here? It's in my packet, but I don't know. Did everybody in the audience get a copy of this resolution we're talking about tonight? Did everybody get a copy of that? Because I have extra copies here.
Just about done. Anybody else have any comments on that?
Clara needs a second to go ahead.
Are you on print preview? Is that why it's not responding?
I didn't set it up.
Okay.
I don't know what we're on. Can you X it, out?
You know, it's at the very top right. I think you're right, Brad. Look, there's a little option to close out, I think. That's not normally there when you.
Correct. I believe it's on a preview mode. We need to exit that to edit it.
And that was probably done so both halves could be up at the same time.
We can change that. Claire, would you like me to help you?
You're pretty good at that, aren't you, Brad? I have trouble with it. Laptop computers.
Okay, there we go.
Right. Oh, now you got rid of all of it.
Sorry.
There it is. No, it's right there on the screen. Just double click that icon.
Oh, I see.
Yes.
Sorry.
Nope, at the top.
It's all right.
At the top. You're getting that. There you go. Yep. Open that. Try again. There you go. There you go.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Oh, that's okay, Claire. Nothing to worry about.
Yeah.
There we go.
Yep. All right.
Right there.
We were a yes
vote shall. Yep. And I suggested that change to on whether to amend. Keep the word amend. Yep. And there you go.
Is that accurate, though?
Yes.
Yeah, if we don't amend it, we don't amend.
What is it? So what does it say, whether?
On whether to amend.
On whether?
On whether to amend the city charter.
Yes, on whether to.
Clara, do you want me to give you a chair? Do you want a chair?
The yes vote will allow the resolution, the charter resolution to go forward.
Correct, which is explained under the yes portion of it.
It's beautiful weather we're having, though.
Weather.
H-E-T-H-E-R, yep. Two, yep.
Okay.
I think that's better, Brad.
So, that's the suggestion.
Can I speak to that, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I was surprised that you took a vote at a previous meeting to set a date for the election without the wording, suggested wording for us at that time, because the statute says, it talks about setting a date for a special election, implies that when you enact a date, you enact the wording at the same time. That's why I came at the last meeting and suggested this wording, and I would like to hand it out to everybody. I don't know whether you reviewed this or not. I think that the there's several problems with that. Here, Joe.
With what you're handing out?
No, with what you have on the screen that we're going to discuss tonight. This is much more leading. I just suggest, instead of having to explain what a yes and a no means, you just say, yes, we're going to amend the charter, or no, we're not going to amend the charter. That when we got the signatures for the over 1,000 town residents, most of them were shocked that the town had moved to amend the charter without their knowledge. They didn't know anything about the fact that y'all were meeting to amend the charter.
It needs to be crystal clear as to why the charter is being amended. Okay.
And if
so, it needs to
well,
be spelled
the wording out. That you've just corrected, just amended there, says whether to amend the city charter. That's exactly what most people are upset about. They're upset that the town amended the city charter without them knowing anything about it.
That's not the point of this discussion tonight,
right,
Councilman.
Right. And there's a lot of people
we've,
that are
we've
upset.
We've moved
if
beyond
we
that. That's why the referendum is happening, because of the claim that people are upset. So
yes.
We put it to a vote
let's
so they
let's
can
see
vote
if they
on
really
it.
Are.
No,
so
I don't
everything you want us to do.
So what you've handed out here. You know, the suggestion I just made would
one,
eliminate. Hang on.
I think I
would
have
eliminate the idea that we're being leading. What you've handed out misses crucial information and is extremely leading.
No, I just think that at the bottom of a paragraph that describes what's happened in our town, you should have yes, we want to amend the charter. Or no, we don't want to amend the charter. That's my suggestion.
Right.
And not try to explain what a yes means, what a no means. Our wording says it permanently authorizes the city council to remove a duly elected member of the by a simple majority vote of four members in either case of an accusation of missing consecutive meetings without pre-approval by the majority vote, or an accusation of a member targeted for removal for a violation of any state, county, and municipal statutes, charters, ethic ordinances, society. This amendment also permanently authorizes the city to censure any of its members by a simple majority vote for anything the majority agrees is censurable, and makes the censured member thereafter subject to recall election through a petition process. I thought that was succinct about what this had done, and then just put
anyone
yes or no below that. Either we want to do that and give that kind of extraordinary power to the city council, or we don't.
All right,
well,
thank you.
Two very brief things. Number one, why would you be opposed to a very clear statement about what a yes or a no vote would mean?
I was opposed to adopting a date of November 15th without
but
the
Councilman,
this, this bit, portion left blank until a later meeting, which is called tonight.
But Councilman, just a moment ago, you said that you were opposed to the yes or the no and the explanation why, and I'm curious as to why you would be opposed to the clarity of why a yes or a no vote would do.
I think I just explained why I think that the paragraph at the top, which should say what happened to us, and the paragraph at the bottom should say a simple yes, I agree that with that, or no, I don't, yes or no. I don't think you need to, I agree with Brad's earlier point that a yes with an explanation about what a yes means is not only necessary, but is subject to accusations of being misleading.
Well, you took what I said out of context entirely.
Why is that out of context?
Because I did not argue against explaining what a yes meant. My point was that we were saying it twice, so I eliminated the first.
Well, it does say yes means this.
It says
and no
yes
means this.
It says yes
under the no, for example, Mr. Mayor. It says no. I vote against the charter amendment, which will prohibit the provisions of removing elected officials.
Right. Now, what I find yours missing is it does not talk about the voter's ability to remove somebody. Instead, you paint it like a bully council, which is not accurate.
Well, it's a simple matter.
You're hiding the fact that this gives citizens the ability to remove somebody.
Yeah, I think that the actual language in the statute is almost more clear than what's been presented here tonight.
Well, my other question is,
here's the actual language of the statute about what can be done to remove an elected official on the ordinance 2016-01.
We understand what you're saying. Let's hear anybody else's comment.
No, I wanted to address Councilman Vigliotti's question.
Anyone else have any comments?
I had just one other point, and that was to what Diane had said on the second part of it, right, where it says under the no vote, no I vote against, the word N does not need to be in there.
Yeah, correct.
Down right there.
All right. Yes, before the words elected officials, remove the word N.
Is this on the no portion?
That's correct.
Yes, sir.
Elected officials. Just delete that word. Yep.
Because
it's grammatically incorrect.
All right, let's
That was my.
A no vote doesn't prohibit anything. The no vote just votes against amending the charter.
If you would be quiet, please. That I would like to say, I don't understand all the contention on this thing. Other towns have it. We're trying to make it nice and clear and plain to us, to our voters. The only thing that I can think of that someone would vote against this would be, or why they would vote against it, is that they plan to do nefarious things. Let's get this done and move on.
Mr. Mayor, the provision in front of us is 2 pages long. The first page looks like this, and it has 5 paragraphs, and then it says, now therefore let it be enacted or resolved, and then it has the wording that you can carry on the second page here. I'd like to discuss the 4th paragraph on that. Could we put that up? Because when we adopt this tonight,
we're only discussing the resolution.
Yeah, right? The resolution is a 2-page resolution, Mr. Mayor.
Everything's free game.
The wording on the ballot is the only thing we're discussing.
Come again?
No.
Wording on the ballot.
No. I was on the impression from the attorney at my initial question, I asked it deliberately, was that we're adopting a resolution tonight, which is a 2-page resolution, and the top part has 5 whereases, and the bottom part has proposed wording.
What would you like to say about
it? Well, the 4th one says, and let me read it. It says, whereas the City Council verified and validated that the referendum petition did contain signatures of at least 20% of the persons qualified to vote in the city of Taneytown general election, and then it goes on to the 5th one. I have been warning the council not to go forward with the process until you actually did, as a council, verify these signatures. The report was given by staff, but was never adopted. I made a motion to adopt it, and it failed for lack of second. It's very important when it talks about the city of Taneytown that it's represented by its elected officials, not just by staff that prepared a good job of counting these signatures. It is done. It was done by elected officials. There was a good deal of rancor about whether we could watch that. We talked about wanting to see how these names were stricken and exactly why we weren't able to do that. And so I disagree that Taneytown has verified and validated the signatures according to the law. The law requires that you adopt the verification report of staff.
It's like everything we do every month. We go over stuff and over stuff and over stuff. We've heard this before.
Stuff we've settled months ago.
This is the resolution
you're
about to adopt.
Not again, please, Don.
I just wanted to say that I believe
the majority of council has decided this.
Yes.
Decision.
Oh, I know I'm in the minority.
You're the only one that disagrees with it.
I know I'm in the minority. In the past month, I've read the law over and over again, and you do need to act to verify these signatures as a council before you can go forward with either calling a special election or adopting
right. Well,
the wording tonight. If you fail to do so, it's quite provocative.
I guess I could
Mr. Mayor, may I?
Before I entertain a motion, maybe I should call for...
Brad wanted to.
Sorry, Brad, what do you...
Just wanted to say, by passing this referendum, we are accepting that.
Yes.
We are saying that there were sufficient signatures, that they were verified, they were validated. We're doing this in one fell swoop.
Yeah.
If you don't want us to accept the petition, say so.
Well, let me ask a question of Mr. Brad, if that's okay with you, Mr. Mayor.
Councilman Wance would be great, thank you.
Okay, is that okay if I do ask a question of another councilman?
Sure.
I'll accept the question.
Okay. If you recall, and I have a copy of it, and I have made multiple copies so people could see it, this report that came from the staff, the reason that it's so critical in the law that the people are given the report and act upon it at the time they receive the report is so that it can come as a motion and a second for debate, because there were two portions of the dismissals of signatures.
This issue has been settled. There was no more discussion on this issue.
But we weren't ever able...
We don't need to talk about it anymore.
Well, that's...
It's been voted on and settled.
My point is this. The law requires you to come...
Your opinion of the law. Don't forget to say that.
Well, I've studied it closely. And,
don't forget to say my opinion of the law.
Well, as I read the law, which I think is very plain, that that these things, because of the accepting that, we could have debated why all the new registers rents were thrown out and why you threw out these other this other group of 86 signatures. We never had an opportunity to do that, so
incorrect.
We were denied due process.
Incorrect.
And so I don't think it's accurate to adopt this resolution number 4 tonight that says that they were were verified, that the signatures...
You've got to vote. You can vote any way you want.
Yeah, if you don't like it, Donald, just vote against it.
Well,
okay?
I've been in the minority a lot. I don't think what you're doing is wise, and so I've been in the minority a lot. I'm not afraid to be in a minority.
How many times do we have to listen to the same thing?
I think the people need to know what's happening.
Conversation's over.
Mr. Mayor, just to clarify, when we received the report, we were all instructed to go through it, to get with the city staff, to look through it ourselves, and individually verify it. Did you take an opportunity to do so?
I do not understand why you're deaf to understand that if you fail to bring it forth with a motion second, we can discuss the merits of how the petitions were received, and then you can vote to overrule me on that. But because of that, we're denied due process.
Well, I'm just explaining how due process was offered, and I'm asking if you took advantage of that.
I did. I made a motion to adopt the report that was presented
before
by our attorney that Claire did all that work on, but you all failed to second my motion or
adopt it. You made a motion to adopt a report before the council had the opportunity to go through it themselves.
Right. Well, I don't question the staff's ability to do a great job, and I think they did a great job.
Are you questioning? You're not questioning the staff?
No, but
then
you
why make such a deal out of it? You got what you wanted.
By not acting upon that report that came from staff, Carl,
can we get to the question?
You have denied due process.
Let's move on.
Of receiving
that's
these signatures.
This is just old hay that's been mown and moldy.
Well, I think it's highly controversial to use a process that's unlawful and denies the intent of the statute. That's all.
All right. Let's. Before I call for a motion.
We need to print it first, Mr. Mayor.
You want to print it first. All right.
Is there any other changes?
Everybody's satisfied with that by consensus.
Any other questions you have or changes?
Well,
let me just
that's a high-risk question when I'm on the council.
let me just suggest one thing. Percent, I believe, should be one word. There's a space in the middle of the word that just bugs me.
Same paragraph, fourth
in
one.
This, yep. Fourth paragraph where it has 20%, if you can just make percent one word, go up three lines.
That's acceptable, though, Brad.
It would just bug me. Thank you.
Oh, if the question is still on the table, are there any other questions?
All right.
I think that
any further before we decide this is what we want by consensus,
Councilman
and everybody
Frazier
has a piece of it in front of them. Does anyone want to change anything else?
Yes, I have something. Okay. One other thing. He said if there are any other questions. I think both under the yes and both under the no, before the word elected, you should write the word duly elected. The thing that makes this an appalling unconstitutional act by the city council, is that these people were elected by the people and they cannot be removed unless they've committed and been convicted of a crime and by a simple majority of this council. So I think the wording adding the word duly elected in front of yes and duly elected officials under no would clarify that in America, people are elected by the people and not and unelected and not thrown out of office by a simple majority of elected officials.
All right.
And by adding the word
duly elected officials, which implies that we go through a lengthy process to make sure we have free and fair elections of elected officials. And the people do that.
Who likes duly? I mean, it sounds redundant to me.
I think that's, it's in the other laws. I studied that this month. Duly elected officials is referred to people who go through the elected process of being put on by the citizens that are qualified to vote.
But isn't that what elected means?
You can be an elected official without being going through the elected process, Councilman Vigliotti. You could fill a vacancy, for example. The people we're talking about were duly elected by the citizens.
But then that would be an appointment, right? Not an election.
No, they'd be elected officials.
Well, if there was a special election. Otherwise, it would be an appointment.
Does that answer your question?
It clutters the resolution and repeats itself. I don't think that word's necessary. I don't vote, though. So does anybody else agree with me or disagree?
Well, all I'm going to say is the definition of the word duly, because depending on how people are trying to use it, simply means in the proper or expected way.
That's right. And
so an appointed official would fill that bill.
That is correct.
So it's not necessary.
It's used a lot of time in law to describe people who've gone through whatever legal process to be to hold the job of an elected official. They're duly elected, which means they
receive... Right, well, time's running out, folks. We're going to have to start moving on here.
What time
do we need to have this start? We need to have this printed off, and we need to bring it to a vote.
Okay, yeah. Well, let's decide. Do we want to include that word?
You want duly?
No, we.
I have no opposition to that word being there.
But we don't need it.
I agree. We don't need it.
So that's not about it.
I think it's good. Do you have to make a motion to?
No.
Well, I'll move that we put the word duly elected official. So we just don't throw it under the rug. It's a great idea.
We're simply amending. That's all. And when we make our final motion, we'll.
Well, I want to know who's opposed to duly elected. That's all. That's why you go to a vote on things. So we have open government. People can tell who's in favor and who's not in favor.
I believe we're at a point to print. Is that correct, Mr. Mayor?
I'm sorry?
Are we at a point that we can print that?
Do we want to leave the word duly? We haven't decided on that or not.
Well, I think it's a great addition.
Let's take a poll. Do you want to leave the word duly?
Oh, yeah, I suggested. I think that would say a lot to the voter.
It does not offend me.
Do you want to leave the word duly? It
doesn't bother me one way or the other.
Do you want to?
We don't need it.
Huh?
We don't need it.
We don't need it.
Right.
I agree we don't, but it's your call.
Well, if it were 2-2, then I would vote to remove it.
But it's not.
But I guess it's 3-2.
I think it's an improvement. I would appreciate your support on that.
3-1. Let's leave it.
Let's leave it.
All right. Well, we're at a point where we can print that off then and show it to the council, and we'll introduce it as a motion.
What will we do in the interim while this is being done, Mr. Mayor, while we wait for the two copies to be done?
We will recess. We'll sit here and enjoy each other's company.
Well, I could have permission.
I thought while we were printing this off,
we should recess.
I'd take comments from the community.
Okay.
Let's recess until they have the actual thing in front of them.
Okay.
You say to recess?
Because we really wanted everybody to have the version in front of them that we're doing, so that when you take comments, everybody's on the same page.
Will you allow comments before we vote?
Let's get a motion to go into recess.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
And we'll reconvene when Claire brings the information back.
I'm going to vote against recessing. This is a good time to take comments, so we don't not rush into 7:30. So please mark that down. I voted against recessing.
I think it's important for Claire to be here while that happens. So.
My name's Jackie Jones, and I live in...
Jackie, we're on recess.
I wanted to make a suggestion.
We're going to accept them after we get our version.
I may not be as nice as that.
I'd like to call the meeting back to order of the special meeting of the Mayor and City Council. City Attorney back to order and correct the statement I made at the recess. I think I may have requested recess for the work session, but that's not the case. It's a special meeting that we had the recess for. Everyone has received a copy of the resolution as it has been amended. And I think I'll do is I entertain a motion to accept the resolution and get a second, and then open the discussion up to the community to see if they have anything to add before we take our final vote. Would anyone care to make a motion to accept the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, now let's have some discussion. First, I'll ask if there's one more time, if there's any discussion from council.
Yes, I would like to say a word here. A motion's been made in seconds to adopt the resolution 2016-28. Which is a two-page resolution that includes five whereases and then proposed language for a special election codifying the date of November 15th, 2016 as the date of a special election. If a majority vote's received in just a few minutes, because of what's been said here today, the city will move forward to a special election on that date. And so I would like to just read one thing before you vote, if that's okay, from the county, from the city charter. City Charter C-209, Adoption of Ordinances. It says, no ordinance, and I'll repeat, no ordinance shall be passed at a meeting in which it is introduced. And let me read that again. I have it highlighted in yellow. It says, no ordinance shall be passed at a meeting in which it is introduced. Now, I have the draft that was given to us without the language in it. From the last meeting, and I think it was illegal to adopt that without having the language at that time. But since that's already happened and can't cry too much over spilled milk, I would just say that today I warned the City Council not to adopt this because it violates the town charter. It says that the regular meeting, special meeting of the council held not less than 6 days or more than 70 days after the meeting at which the ordinance has been introduced, it shall be passed. Or passed, or amended, or rejected, or its consideration shall be deferred unto some later date. This is our town charter, so I have to vote against the ordinance, and I encourage every member to vote against this, because it violates our town charter to introduce a new language that's just been copied by Claire, bring it up here, and pass it as an ordinance of the town. And I warn you to vote no on the question before us, because it violates the town charter.
Thank you, Councilman. Now, I'd like to ask if any comments from the community. We only have a very short period of time, so 2 minutes, and I'll let Henry be the timekeeper.
Mr. Mayor, before we do that, can I just respond to Councilman Frazier?
I would love it if somebody would give consideration to the good things I bring up.
Great, thank you. You read it exactly as the charter states it. The only problem is this is a resolution and not an ordinance. They're two very different things.
It says no ordinance
correct,
shall
be and this is a resolution.
This is an ordinance.
Meeting. Or which it is introduced. If you introduce this tonight, which you could do it, you could vote on it on Tuesday's meeting. Monday's a holiday, it's Columbus Day. You could vote on it on Tuesday the 6th, the 11th, at the regular meeting. But then you'd have to change the date to Sunday, November the 20th, or Monday, November 20th.
Are you confused about the difference between an ordinance and a resolution?
I don't agree that this portion of the charter doesn't have this resolution doesn't have the effect of law, and it is a action of the council to set a special election. Your distinguishing those two words is not germane to the question
things. I can speak to that issue.
Resolution are two different acts.
Well, I'd like to argue that, but I know I Shakespeare said,
all right,
methinks
well,
thou doth protest too much.
Right.
I can speak.
We've got 2 minutes.
Is this on?
Please.
Can anybody hear me? I can speak exactly to that issue. Just because it says ordinance doesn't mean it doesn't include a resolution, because section 4304 D5, it says if the petition complies with this section, the legislative body shall specify by resolution adopted in accordance with its normal legislative procedure. So that is your normal legislative procedure. I've been observing it. You introduce an ordinance or a resolution, and then usually it's adopted either at least 6 days after that. So according to this piece of law, section 4304D5, which is the referendum charter amendment, the legislative body shall specify by resolution with its normal legislative procedure. So I guess I could ask anybody, do you show me any other legislative procedure in the code or the charter that tells you
when you should
do that?
Maybe the attorney could address. Doesn't this section that I read and Ms. Adelaide brings up apply here, that it says no ordinance shall be passed at the meeting in which is introduced? I'm just plain reading the language there. This not only was not complete when presented to us, then it was not complete when we began the meeting tonight, Mr. Mayor. And tonight, I warn you not to vote for it, because tonight we just got the thing and you're passing it in violation of the charter at the meeting in which it was introduced.
Jay, say something.
You're incorrect, both of you.
How? Both of you. How can that be incorrect? I can read the charter.
You read it, and you read it perfectly. You read it, and you read it perfectly. And I guess that's the difference of understanding the application versus just reading it. Basically, the law says a resolution. A resolution is not the same as an ordinance, okay? Even though you think it is not. As far as our normal procedures, resolutions can be voted on the same night, ordinances must be introduced, and then they are passed at a subsequent meeting. We do this every month. The example, the water resolution. That's on one agenda on the month, it's voted upon, and then that's it. The next month, you have a different resolution. I guess
It says normal legislative.
Henry, I could not turn my phone off.
But Mr.
So, now with that off, so this, the deal that we're really talking about is there is a difference between an ordinance and a resolution, regardless of whether you want to read into it that there is or not, there is a difference. And as far as the charter is called, you pass a charter resolution, you pass an annexation ordinance. They're in the statutes, they're different things. When we pass an ordinance, we have that provision which you aptly quoted. But when you pass a resolution, it does not apply. And it's that simple.
But section 4304D says specify by resolution. This is a resolution.
Correct.
In accordance with its normal legislative procedure. Well, I didn't get my whole time.
Normal legislative procedures are
resolutions. Anyone else care to address the council?
Also, there's a pending open meetings board complaint on this. And why don't you wait until the complaint has been ruled on by the Attorney General's office?
Just by waiting until Tuesday to adopt this now that everybody's got the
phone. What's the rush?
Also incorrect. What is the rush and incorrect is I specifically gave you an outline at the last meeting, and I specifically stated that when you had a special meeting, you had to adopt it at the special meeting night. If you'd like, you could have another meeting tomorrow, or you could have another meeting Friday.
No. It
but
says
if you do not want to
days.
Have that section does not apply, Councilman. We've already dealt with that.
But
the
why
state
the
law
hasty
basically
graffito on our town charter?
Why do
why
what?
Do that? The hasty graffito on our town charter.
Well,
heard.
You're the one that's destroying the town charter.
Yeah.
Because
why
you're not applying it correctly.
Why aren't you waiting until the open meetings complaint board has ruled on this?
Why wouldn't you take that for an answer?
Why wouldn't you wait until Tuesday now that this has been introduced?
Because it's beyond the time limit.
Right. Why won't
you just have to move the special election to the 21st, that's all.
And as I told you, it cannot happen any day in November but the 15th. That's the day in November it can happen.
No, the date is incorrect too, because if you can't adopt
anyone else, I've got two more minutes for somebody to make a comment.
Hi, Robin Frazier. My concern is that the description of what the ordinance does is not elaborated on enough. And it seems to me that the actual language, those three bullets that's in the charter, are more clear than the shortened sentences here.
Right here.
And I don't have it in
Ms.
front
Frazier,
of me. Can you read it?
I did that. I bracketed those. We have 5 resolution points, but this is much shorter than what they're adopting now. And this is the actual law.
Waste time, Don.
So in the very least, I think you should read that. I think you should read the actual language because it does explain it a little bit better. But this says, in the very least, for 3 unexcused consecutive meeting absences, it should at least say as decided by the majority vote of council, because that makes a big difference, in my opinion. That shows that the council is deciding whether the people are excused or unexcused by majority vote, which is one of the problems with the ordinance, because it can be unequal justice under the law, because you all are voting on what's excused and what isn't. And likewise, on the second bullet, violations of criminal law, federal, state law, county codes, the city ethics ordinance, or provisions of the city charter and code, as decided by the majority vote of the council. Once again, it would be only if the majority decides that you broke one of those codes and they want to move forward with removing you. So I would at least explain
one more
that
speaker.
Much. It's very misleading and deceitful.
Or to make a speech. All right, hearing nothing, we have a motion and a second to adopt the resolution 2016-28 that is before you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And opposed?
I'm opposed to that.
Okay,
Mr. Mayor?
Thank you very much.
I would like to have just one word to explain my no vote. It's extraordinary for the council to take up the expulsion of a duly elected official on an accusation, not a conviction. This law allows people to, on an accusation of wrongdoing, not a crime nor a misdemeanor, to remove a duly elected official. Highly controversial.
Mr. Mayor,
what it also does is takes away the public's right to call a referendum to remove an elected official.
Why would we want to take away the public's
right? That's something
rights.
Else that's going to be
a
no
understand.
Vote that's going to prevent.
How strange it has become in Taneytown.
Okay. Can I have a motion to adjourn the special meeting?
So moved.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Yeah.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
All right, we'll reconvene in about 4 minutes with our work session. I call to order the Mayor and City Council for the Council Workshop for Wednesday, October the 5th, 2016, and let Councilman Ebal lead us in the pledge.
Oh. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. We have a very full agenda tonight, so I hope we're out here before midnight. But our first order of business is to open a public hearing for Ordinance 26-2016, which has to do with the amended sign ordinance allowing that electronic billboard down at the park. Would anybody like to speak to that issue?
I just would say that the adoption of this ordinance, where there was no ordinance before, does more than affect a single sign. It affects the future of an installation of signs throughout Taneytown in perpetuity. So
right.
I correct you on that.
Anybody, member of the public, like to speak on this issue?
Why wouldn't they be the same for everyone?
Downtown zone starts from approximately the former Sheets property, and it extends to, does it include the Lutheran Church?
I think
it's down that area that it ends.
Another,
it also includes portions of Frederick Street and York Street near the square. But there is a, I can find the map if you'd like to see it.
Website.
It is on the website, yes.
And then it, of course, says all bulletin boards incorporating electronic display board must be approved by the planning commission. Again, I think that's just way too much government. I don't know why you would want to have everyone who wants a bulletin board document and electronic message display board document be approved by the commission. It should just be rules that everybody can read and follow. And then if you have an exception to that, that's when you would be coming up with a board. I spoke to the planning board before, and that's how it used to be. But this is an awful lot of government incorporated in this sign stuff, making decisions where they might say, okay, one person is not okay to another. And I much prefer that if government is going to make these kind of rules, that they're more across the board so everybody knows I can do this, I can't do this.
Yeah.
I go before the planning and zoning board and hopefully they like it because I just think it gives them way too much power. So that's my.
Okay, we got to move on, Robin.
Mr.
Mayor. I didn't set a time limit for the public hearing. We probably need to hold these comments to 3 minutes because we do have a full agenda. The council have an opportunity to discuss this in a minute.
Just wanted to follow up on that point.
Anyone else from the public care to make a statement regarding the electronic board? All right, well, let's continue on
Mr. Mayor,
resolution.
Just
okay.
A moment to respond to that. The word all in that sentence is very troubling because I brought up, when this was in very early draft stage, that you can buy at Walmart a small open and close sign. Under the way I read this in its current form, every little electronic sign, the word all means all. And I think that it would be much better, as Commissioner Frazier said, to define a size that would require review of the Planning Commission. I can't believe you'd adopt an ordinance giving that kind of extraordinary power to the Planning Commission.
When the ordinance comes before the council on Monday night, just you can make a motion
take
to amend.
That word all out,
well, you,
and
you
maybe
could
we can
make
get
a motion
some
to
idea.
Amend.
Donald, weren't you for this 100% last month?
No. There was no law.
You don't have to keep going. It just seems.
You asked me a question. May I respond?
My recollection is that you were against or totally for this.
No, I can't understand why 3 years we want an electronic sign at the park and we cannot get it from this town.
Councilman, nothing's holding up the electronic
sign
for the park.
Because people hold up the process. That's why. Because people stonewall. That's why.
You're about to now adopt an ordinance that regulates every sign for the rest of my life. And so that deserves a little time to discuss.
Mr. Mayor.
Right. Why not remove the word all, Commissioner Vigliotti?
Councilman.
Vigliotti. Yeah,
if I can speak to that, here's what I can't figure out is the different views that I just got. Mm-hmm. We have anti-government overreach, and we have why is this holding up your sign? Whereas you even said the city doesn't need this, they could do it anyway. That's government overreach.
The purpose of me being on the city council is to be concerned about adoption of new laws. This is a new ordinance that will govern electronic signs forever. And I think
right.
that I'm not, I don't understand you. I don't understand, what's your point?
Well, if we don't pass the ordinance, we don't get a sign.
That's right.
Simple as that.
Right, I don't agree with attorneys giving us bad advice again. If there is no statute,
we haven't even talked during this meeting yet.
Jay didn't even speak.
Prohibiting an act.
This is getting out of hand.
It is.
I'm going to close the public hearing for the
if there is no statute, it's
ordinance
not
26-2016 amendment to the sign ordinance. Well, this will be on the docket for Monday night for approval. It can be amended any way you choose on Monday night. Next, we have a presentation from our auditors, Draper and McGinley. And they're going to discuss the final financial statements for this past year. So I will turn it over to the ladies at the on the panel table there.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Michelle Mills, and I'm audit partner with Draper McGinley. With me tonight is Addie White. She was a member of the team that worked on this year's audit. And we are here to present the draft results of the audit. Each of you were provided a copy of the handouts of the slide. You're welcome to follow along on the projected slides or from the handout. First, I'd like to just highlight our scope of services. We were engaged to perform a financial statement audit for the fiscal year ending June 30, 2016. I like to remind management of their responsibilities. Management is responsible for the financial statements. Our responsibility as auditors is to plan and perform the audit to obtain reasonable assurance that there are no material misstatements to the financial statements and to express an opinion on those financial statements based on our audit. The audit was performed in accordance with generally accepted accounting auditing standards and government auditing standards. The city will receive an unmodified report on their financial statements. And again, I just want to clarify, unmodified means a clean audit opinion, which means that the financial statements are fairly stated in all material respects. I'd like to pause just for a moment because included in the final report that will be published is a management's discussion and analysis. That is not in your draft report that you received in the packet. Management has since prepared that. We are in the process of reviewing it, but I'd like to encourage you to read it as council members, mayor and council, because it has a lot of good information. You'll see in the draft audit report, government accounting standards requires two sets of financial statements. We're required to report government-wide financial statements as well as fund level. And throughout the slides at the very bottom, it will refer you back to the page where you'll see the financial statements, and you'll see that the government-wide starts on pages 9 and 10, and the fund level continues from pages 11 to 17. So we're ready to begin. The first required government-wide financial statement is the statement of net position. And at the end of fiscal year 2016, the city's government-wide total assets were just under $40 million. And you'll see from the pie chart the differentiation between the business-type activities, which is your water and sewer, and your governmental activities, which is everything else. Your governmental activities were just over $11.2 million, and that comprised 28% of the total assets. And your business-type activities were just over $28.7 million, and that was 72% of the total. This next slide illustrates the significant assets for each of the business, for the governmental activities as well as the business type activities. So at a quick glance, you can see governmental activities has just over $5.5 million of cash and cash equivalents, and capital assets of just over $5.5 million. The total assets, again, for governmental activities were just over $11.2 million. Side by side, the business type activities had cash and cash equivalents of nearly $3.3 million, and their capital assets were $23.8 million. The city's total liabilities were almost $19 million. And that was a 3% decrease from fiscal year 2015. And you'll see that the majority of the liabilities are in the business type activities, where we have about $14.9 million for business type and a little over $4 million for our governmental type. And here's a quick breakdown of those significant liabilities. For our governmental activities, we have debt of about $1.6 million. Our net pension liability, which is new, we were required last fiscal year to begin accounting for it in the financial statements of the city. That's over $2 million for governmental activities. And our total liabilities, as I mentioned, were just over $4 million. If you look at the business type activities, our debt is $14.3 million, and our net pension liability for the business type activities is just over $197,000. This next slide just introduces some terminology. A year ago, government accounting standards changed the requirements of the financial statements for municipalities. They introduced new terms, deferred inflows and outflows. So I'm just highlighting the definition for you, as well as pointing out what the inflows and outflows were for each business type. For governmental activities, it was just over $519,000. Business type activities, it was $395,000. For the city, it was attributable to pension and the debt refinancing that occurred in the business type activities a year ago. Our deferred inflows are all attributable to the pension, and for governmental activities, it was just over $168,000, and for business type activities, it was about $15,000. When you're reading the financial statements, the assets plus the deferred outflows minus the liabilities and your deferred inflows equals something called net position. The governmental activities net position was just over $7.5 million. And for the business type activities, it was $14.2 million. So the next slide again reiterates the total net position of being for the total net position at just over $21.7 million and broken down between governmental and business type activities. When we talk about net position, we're required to break it down into the various components. And if you look at governmental activities, you'll see that we have capital assets net of related debt of just over $3.9 million, and our unrestricted net position is about $3.6 million for the total $7.5 million. For our business type activities, our capital assets net of the related debt is just over $9.5 million. We have $25,000 that is restricted, and the balance of $4.6 million is unrestricted. Now I'm going to reiterate one more time. At the very bottom of each slide is where you can go back and look if you want to see where the data is being pulled from. For the purpose of time tonight, we're trying to illustrate what we think is most important. You have a 40-some page document in front of you, so we're trying to highlight what we think is most important for you to understand. This next slide is the statement of activities, and this is the second required government-wide financial statement. And for governmental activities, in the very first column, it shows that the total expenses for the town, for the city, was just over $4 million. We had charges for services of about $186,000. We had operating grants and contributions of just over $397,000. Capital grants and contributions of about $47,000. And our general revenues, which comprises income taxes, property taxes, was just over 3.1. When you take all of the revenues and subtract all of the expenses, you find that there was a change in net position of a decrease of $293,000. This next slide takes the business type activities and does the same thing. The total expenses were just under $2.9 million. The charges for services were over $2.8 million. We had significant capital grants in the current period of over $3 million, and our general revenues were about $133,000. The change in net position for the business type activities, largely related to the capital grant, is over $3 million. So I'm going to pause for a moment. And now we're going to change our focus, and we're going to talk fund-level financial statements. Again, I mentioned that we're required to report two sets of financial statements. The government-wide is presented as a commercial business, where we have recorded capital assets, accounted for debt. Our principal payments are a reduction of our debt, and we've accounted for depreciation expense. The fund level statements have a different measurement focus, and so many of the things that you see in the government-wide financial statements are not present in the fund level. So when we talk about the governmental fund type for the city, you have one fund type, and that's the general fund. The general fund has just over $5.6 million of assets. It has $284,000 of liabilities. And from this measurement focus, the difference between the assets and the liabilities is something called fund balance. Before, we were talking about net position. The fund balance at the end of fiscal year 2016 was just under $5.4 million. The fund balance is required to be broken down into various buckets, and we've listed them there. We have a non-spendable piece, which was just over $18,000. We have $478,000, which is committed. We have a small amount that's assigned, and the balance becomes unassigned. And I will say, in the notes to the financial statements, gives you all of the definitions for each of these categories that will help you have a better understanding as to what they mean for financial reporting purposes. This next slide looks at the revenues and expenditures of the general fund. We had revenues of just over $3.7 million. Our expenses were just about $3.6 million, and we had an excess of revenues over expenditures of $133,000. Now, this slide's important because it does a reconciliation to show you from a fund level perspective to a government-wide perspective how we got from point A to point B. So at a fund level, we have an excess of revenues over expenses of $133,000. However, when I spoke to you earlier and I said that governmental activities had a change in net assets of a decrease of $293,000, here are all the reconciling items that get you there. So in fiscal year 2016, we had capital outlay of about $147,000. We had depreciation expense of over $395,000. Our debt service expenditures, which is our principal payments on our debt, was just over $105,000. And then the next largest item in the list would be your net pension adjustment, which was a decrease of $282,000. So you're looking at from a fund level perspective to a government-wide perspective, and here are all the reconciling items. The same slide takes a look from a fund balance, which we talked about, and when we said the governmental fund had just over $5.3 million in a fund balance, but yet had net position of $7.5 million, here's all of the adjustments to get from point A to point B. When we're talking about a fund level financial statement, we don't record our capital assets because that's not the measurement focus. So we're adding back nearly $5.6 million. We also don't account for the deferred inflows or outflows because in most cases it's attributable to the pension, and the net pension liability only is reflected on your government-wide financial statements. We have some changes in some of our liabilities, as well as the biggest items would be our long-term debt. Our long-term debt appears only on a government-wide financial statement and not on a fund level, as well as the net pension liability only appears on a government-wide financial statement. So if you take all of the items in the middle, you get from 5.4 to 7.5. This next slide compares the revenues for the general fund current period to the prior fiscal year. And if you look at a quick glance, you can see that I would say for the most part, property taxes, income taxes, license and permits were roughly about the same year over year, modest increases. The intergovernmental revenues did have a $90,000 increase over the prior year, and largely attributable to some reimbursement money you received from the state due to the storm. This next slide gives you the same focus from an expenditure basis, and it's comparing fiscal year 2016 expenditures by function to fiscal year 15, and again, just gives you a nice snapshot of how you compare. The next few slides are doing the same thing for the utility fund. You'll see that the operating revenues, there was a very slight decrease. It was less than 1% of operating revenues year over year. We did have a slight increase in operating expenses from 2.2 to about 2.3. And fiscal year 2015, we had operating income of just over $726,000 compared to about $579,000 in fiscal year 16. This next slide illustrates how we get from operating income to change in net position. And so while we had operating income of $578,000, we also need to account for non-operating items, interest income and interest expense, as well as our capital grants and contributions. So earlier I mentioned that there was a change in net position of $3 million, and that's how we got there. This next slide is a quick snapshot of the general fund. You adopt a budget. Right now you'll see that there has been some budget amendments. I think later tonight you'll be presented another budget amendment. This represents where we were at the time of audit and does not include the budget amendment that you'll be seeing. Once it's been approved, we'll update the RSI for that budget amendment. So our revenues were anticipated at 3.512. We ended up being 3.7. It was a positive variance of 244,000. Our expenditures, we had final budget expected to be just under 4 million. We ended up being 3.6 million with a positive variance of about 345,000. And again, the net change in fund balance for the year was a positive 133. So, I mentioned earlier that we did the audit in accordance with government auditing standards, and as a result, we needed to look at the city's internal controls over financial reporting and compliance. And we're required to communicate in writing to you any items that we identify that would be a material weakness, and we've provided the definition of what a material weakness is. And you can read along. It's a deficiency or combination of deficiencies in internal control such that there is a reasonable possibility that a material misstatement will not be prevented or detected and corrected on a timely basis. We did not identify anything that we believe to be a material weakness during the current audit. The next level of reporting is whether or not there's anything that is a significant deficiency. And that is a deficiency or combination of deficiencies in internal control that is less severe than a material weakness, yet important enough to merit attention by those charged with governance, which would be you. So we did identify one significant deficiency in internal controls, and that's on page 44 of the audit report. So if you all wouldn't mind switching to the draft report, we can go over it from here. Good. On page 44, in the schedule of findings and responses, our first finding was finding 2016-001, allocation of cost. When allocating costs to various city activities and departments, budget estimates do not qualify as support for charges. Budget estimates may be used for interim financial reporting, but there must be a process in place to validate that the final costs are fairly representative of the level, actual level of effort. Under condition, you'll see that during fiscal year 2016, we noted that the city allocated personnel cost based on the percentages in the adopted budget rather than the employee's actual level of effort. During the audit, management recalculated the applicable salary and fringe cost based on the labor distribution report, and an audit adjustment was made to move $307,000 of cost from the general fund to the utility fund. Our recommendation is that management implement a process where employees' time is recorded to the various departments based on their level of effort. Without changes to the current approach of recording personnel cost, there is a risk of material misstatement as noted above. We have inserted management's response to the finding. Management will redesign the timesheets to reflect the allocation of costs for both management and hourly employees, and management will instruct on the need to keep a weekly accounting of time In most cases, it is difficult to account on a daily basis, and this will be implemented within 60 days. In performing our audit, we did not identify any issues of non-compliance that are required to be reported under government auditing standards. The last item we passed out earlier is what we call the required communications. This is a boilerplate document. The items that are covered in here are those that are required to be communicated. It is addressed to mayor and council. It reminds everyone that we've audited the financial statements and that professional standards require us to communicate the following. Under significant audit findings, you'll see that management is responsible for selecting appropriate accounting policies, and the significant accounting policies of the city are disclosed in note 2 to the financial statements, which is in your draft packet. There were no new accounting policies adopted in the fiscal year 2016. We noted no transactions that lacked authoritative guidance or consensus, and all significant transactions have been recorded in the proper period. The next paragraph reminds everyone that in preparing financial statements, accounting estimates are used, and we've highlighted two of the more sensitive estimates. One is determining the estimated useful lives of assets. We've looked at the lives that have been assigned to the various classes of assets, and they appear reasonable. At the very bottom, we have disclosed that the allowance for uncollectible accounts at the end of fiscal year 2016, again, which is an estimate, was just over $24,000. At the top of page 2, it highlights a number of significant financial statement disclosures. Again, all of the note disclosures are in the draft that you have, but we've highlighted a few that we think are important for you to be aware of. In note 2 to the financial statements, the cash deposits of the city were fully collateralized as required by law. As disclosed in note 3, the total assessable base for 2016 was $559 million, and the property tax rate remained at 0.37. In note 4, we're highlighting the capital activity that occurred in both the governmental activities as well as the business type activities. For governmental activities, there were asset additions of just over $125,000, and our depreciation expense was $395,000. In comparison, our business type activities, we had additions of about $6.5 million, and depreciation expense of over $985,000. And again, just as a reminder, the additions would have been the wastewater treatment plant upgrade because it was placed in service in fiscal year 16. As disclosed in note 5, the outstanding debt for the governmental activities was just under $1.6 million, and $109,000 will be due in the next 12 months. For our business type activities, our debt was just over $14.3 million, and $677,000 will be due within the next 12 months. As disclosed in note 6, the city contributed over $230,000 to the Maryland State Retirement and Pension System for the employees in fiscal year 2016. And lastly, as disclosed in note 12, there was a prior period adjustment to correct grant revenue for a reimbursement that was in the wrong fiscal year. The beginning of the year net position for business type activities was increased by $269,000, and we can talk about that a little bit more further. There were no significant difficulties in dealing with management in performing the audit. The next section highlights the audit adjustments. You'll see that we had two items that were more significant. One was to correct for a double booking and reclassify interest accrual to accrued expenses, which is about $74,000 for the utility fund. And this one is the prior period adjustment I mentioned above. And just to give a little bit more information on it, the grant reimbursement was received in fiscal year 2016. The cost had been incurred over a number of years. It was unclear, I think, at some point as to whether or not the city would be reimbursed, and it was in fiscal year 15 where it became a little more apparent that we were going to be reimbursed under a pilot program. So when I say in the wrong period, the request for reimbursement occurred in 16, the funds came in 16, but we really could have requested the money in fiscal year 15. So we did a prior period adjustment rather than restating, than overstating the current year revenue. At the top of page 3, there were no disagreements with management with regard to any financial accounting or reporting matter. Management will provide us with a signed client representation letter once this report has been approved. We're not aware of management consulting with any other CPA firms to get a difference of opinion on any applicable matter. Under other matters, it just highlights our responsibility for the management's discussion and analysis and some of the required supplemental information that accompanies the report. And again, our responsibility is to read it, make certain that it's consistent with our audit procedures, but we do not express an opinion on it. And the last item is just, again, highlighting the restriction on use, that this information is for mayor and council and management and is not intended to be distributed to others. And that concludes my part.
Thank you very much.
Any questions?
A quick question, if it's okay, Mr. Mayor. On page 27, I was looking at the interest rates on some of these debts. The first item shows $294,700 at a rate of 4.6% average interest. My impression of reviewing this, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that at the end of the time listed here, like May the 1st, 2034, that we will have paid off this amount. Is that correct?
Correct.
And that's right. And so as I go down the list to the just under 1.6 million that you referenced while you were covering this page, I can use this sheet to estimate the maturity of these bonds and the paying of this debt. Is that correct?
If you go to page 29 will highlight for you, again, this is citywide, so this is picking up your governmental as well as business type, but this shows your debt service payments for the next 5 years and then every 5 year increments after that until it's fully paid off. So you're looking at going out to 2056 before you would be completely paid off.
Barring any new encumbrances.
Correct.
I thought that was pretty good news. I would like to know whether or not you think it would be reasonable to refinance things at 4.6 and 4.24 and extend the terms on those in order to lower. One of the reasons for not lowering the water rate is that we're always told the debt is so great we must pay our fair share. But I'm just wondering whether a different management of this portfolio we've been presented tonight might result in a lower burden. I've done that with my own home mortgages.
You just have to be cautious because often there's a prepayment penalty associated with some of this. So before you would go further, you would have to evaluate which ones, and I'm not even sure, quite frankly.
Ms. Fassett,
sure,
mentioned that
the auditor
at that
would
time.
Make that statement anyway. I'm not sure that would fall within your preview.
It's a management decision.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, the review of this audit, which is very good and very thorough, and I appreciate it, very clear to understand, has reminded me that we've talked about some things that we need to talk about again. Does anybody remember what those things are?
Mayor, if you give me the floor for just a second. If everyone will remember, back in May, at budget time, I presented a policy for how to utilize non-recurring income due to growth. And council adopted that along with the budget by a 4-1 vote. And basically, the policy said that some of the money that we had due to new growth would be used as a balance against water and sewer rates. And we agreed at the time when we passed it that we would bring it up again when the audit rolled around, and with the audit being as good as it is, I actually want to suggest that, you know, maybe at this point we bring Davenport back in conjunction with the policy to reevaluate our entire financial situation and to see if water and sewer rates can be lowered. And Jay, you know, I'd like to get everybody's opinion on that, but in terms of process, Jay, maybe you could mention briefly what the process would entail in terms of doing that.
To bring on a consultant, you basically have already vetted Davenport as your financial advisor, but their letter of engagement covered for what they did for you. So you just execute a new letter of engagement, which I think would be simple to do. The issue that you have is that it's got to be timely. One of the things about the Vigliotti policy, if you will, that we adopted as part of the budget was the fact that we couldn't make decisions on actuals because in the budget. We were budgeting things and they weren't actuals, and we said we'd always have a lag time, that these actuals are already old. They're already for July. They're not actuals right now. So if you want to base any budget things to happen this coming year, meaning you want to talk about rates, then you need to study the rates now so that you can do whatever things you need to have done, whatever they suggest that you do, so that you're dealing with actuals when you go into the budget frame, if that makes any sense. So, yeah. And so the action you need to take, Councilman, is just basically get the council to authorize an engagement, and then the engagement letter would happen.
Would that have to come through way of a vote on Monday night, or was just like a general direction of?
They would prefer, usually, the financial advisors now are governed under pretty strict SEC regulations that you at least noted in the minutes, but most of my other clients, they just do it by motion. Like, so you'd make a motion to engage Davenport to study what it is you want them to study and pass a motion to do it.
What you're saying is very true, and the plan that was laid out for us 5 years ago has really come to fruition. And it may be a good time to relook at this whole situation, and I guess we could entertain a motion on Monday night to re-engage the analysis and see where we stand, I guess, before budget time. So, Joe, that's a good suggestion.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, Joe asked for comments. I don't think these numbers are that complex. I think that this well-done report, I don't believe you need to hire an expert to make a change in fiscal policy. The reason I voted against your policy back in May was because I thought we could get rate relief now. We got a bill for $404 on 17,000 gallons of water just a few days ago. I used 19,000 at my house in Glen Burnie, and the bill's $197 for 19,000 gallons of water with five people living in the house. So I know that water is high in Taneytown. So my question at this time is, why would we need to hire an expert when they've laid out, this wonderful report has laid out ways to reduce the debt burden and to give rate relief now?
Well, I'm sorry, please go ahead.
I think the reason we should hire an expert is because none of us are experts.
That's right.
That's a good idea.
I mean, 100%. You're not an expert on water and sewer.
I'm more than I was a year ago.
But you may know more, but you're not an expert. And that's why we rely on experts to give us
an expert. I always heard somebody from more than
50
miles
away. And I would be
away.
Much more comfortable bringing somebody in who actually knew the numbers and could actually go into the details of the number to let us know whether or not this was possible.
There are so many things that we can overlook not being experts, and we need expert advice.
And if we overlook, we run a risk of seriously damaging the economic future.
That's right.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's what we've said all along. That's why we've been so cautious about this.
So would everybody be okay with that being on the agenda for Monday night?
Absolutely.
All right, let's do that.
Good idea.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments on the audit?
I was just debating if I should interject on that last comment. The intent of an enterprise fund or the utility fund is to make certain that you are charging, your service charges are sufficient to cover your operating cost. And so, again, I think it would be prudent to have an expert come into play so that when you do it, you know that you've covered all of your bases. Because when I look at this, and while there were positive numbers, the one thing that you don't see on here, because we're following full accrual gap, is that you do have very heavy debt, and those principal payments aren't showing up on your operating statement. So it gives a false sense that it's doing better, I think, than it may actually be doing. So that's the only thing I caution you on. And that's the type of thing that they would be looking at, because they would be looking at the big picture. And while you certainly have made improvement, I believe year over year, it was because there was a conscious effort to raise the rates for many years as a result of Davenport coming in here 5 or 6 years ago.
Thank you.
Exactly right.
On page 44 of the report, you estimated $307,600 $1 from cost of the shift from the general fund to the utility fund, and I brought that up before. I estimated the number at $319,000 at the time I produced this little handout called Why Your Water Bill's Going Up. Would the difference between your number and my number just be the fact that we didn't maintain the constant yield rate, and actually there was a slight creeping up in the taxes received from real estate?
No, this was based on the labor distribution report as to how employees were accounting for their time. What we found is because, and again, correct me at any point if I'm not saying this correctly, salaried personnel don't account for their time the same way that the hourly employees do. And so when there were budget estimates used, when we stepped back and looked at those estimates and said, are they really reflective of the amount of time each of these salaried employees are spending, it wasn't reasonable. It wasn't reasonable to have, again, a city manager spending 100% of their time on general government activities in their position. They're obviously overseeing the whole entire city. So some portion of his time should properly be reflected in the utility operations. And there were multiple things that occurred in fiscal year 16 that would attribute to even more than what traditionally may have been the typical charges. So we did a kind of a step back and said, these estimates aren't close to what really happened. And so that's how we arrived at our number. I'm not sure how you got to yours.
Well, the budget we were given, and it's on my sheet here, says 50% of the town manager's $91,000 salary was spent on whippoorwill drive at the sewer plant. I just don't believe that. I don't think that really happened.
Well,
I think that they shifted some staff around to make things work out. And I'm amazed that you brought it up this evening on page 44.
Well, I'm glad the correction has been made.
Mr. Mayor, can we clarify this correction? We did not allocate enough hours to the utility fund, so you had to move money to it to cover that. The budget cycle we are in now, we have better allocated those hours.
Absolutely.
Okay.
We've done it right this year.
Yes.
Didn't do it right last year.
Thank you.
All right. Good. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time with the city and your analysis.
Yeah.
And thank you, staff, for a pretty respectable audit.
Thank you.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, we need to move into the fiscal year 2016 budget amendment and the fiscal year 2017 budget amendment. This is contained in your packet. Who wants to address that? Are you going to address that, Henry, or is Bobby Joe going to address that?
Henry should address that, probably.
I think Bobby Joe is
Bobby Joe,
treasurer.
That's even better.
Okay, so as Michelle presented the audit, the general fund at the back of your, on page 39, had a net change in fund balance of $133,000. But because of our charter, we're not allowed to overspend in are certain categories. So we had to take a look at those high-level categories to see which departments did overspend and do a budget amendment for that. So even though we didn't overspend for the whole picture, there were departments that did overspend, and the way our charter is written, we must do a year-end budget amendment for that. So what you have in front of you is, we'll look at the bottom first. I just did it at a very high level. So we had two departments, economic development and the streets, and the public works department were overspent. So for the economic development, the main cause of that is a grant. So we had expenditures going out for that facade grant. And if we look up top, we actually had revenue coming in. So it nets out to zero, but it did cause that budget to overspend, but we did have revenue to balance that out. On the streets side, At a very high level, I chose the salaries, and we had not budgeted enough in street salaries. So $65,000, we're doing a budget amendment for that. And then at top, to offset that, we're going to do a budget amendment for the highway user revenues of $6,200. We also got a grant in for the emergency storm of $69,000 to help offset those street salaries. In addition to that, you'll see that we did not get the full grant for the LED retrofit, so I back that out. And also, you'll see personal property. We received additional personal property. So the net effect, you'll see at the bottom, is $85,200. And that will balance the budget per quarter so that those areas aren't showing as overspent. Any questions on that?
Questions?
No, sir.
Now, these budget amendments will be up for approval on Monday night.
Thank you, Bobby Joe.
Or Tuesday night, I'm sorry. Okay, next we have the approval of the minutes for September the 7th and September the 12th regular minutes. Does anybody have any additions or corrections to those minutes?
On the September 7th, that's my anniversary, we had a council meeting on my anniversary. At the bottom it says public comments under the agenda item, but there are no public comments written on the agenda. Why do we do that? If we had public comments, why don't we allow some coverage of what was said and done during that period of the meeting?
Because we simply recognize the votes taken during the meetings.
But that's really, the guidance for municipalities from MML is that the minutes reflect a summary that could be read by a passerby.
Like
what
we talk
really
about
happened
this every
meeting.
Month, don't we?
Yep,
don't we talk
do.
About this
we
every
do.
Month? Yeah. No, we don't need to talk about it again this month.
Well, I just wondered if all you right. knew why that
Any
was.
Any other additions or corrections?
Yes, on the September 12th meetings, it says that Frazier opposed the motion, the draft resolution. And the reason I opposed it was because the draft report was never received by the council, as I said earlier in the meeting today.
Can you say that earlier today already?
So mm-hmm. I don't believe that this is accurate. It doesn't explain what happened at the council during that time. The words reported, never accepted by the council should be added. Also, on the final statement, it says statement regarding open meetings complaint. I wanted to know whether or not the minutes were referring to the open meetings complaint that was filed in July the 6th with the Open Meetings Compliant Board because of the failure to be able to review the petitions, or the open meetings lawsuit that's been filed because of the illegal secret meeting that was held on June the 22nd while I was in Tanzania. Which open meetings complaint are you talking about?
That one was regarding the lawsuit.
Yeah, that's what it says, to seek outside counsel
yeah.
for the lawsuit.
That's
we did. That probably could be clarified.
So there's no, the outside counsel is not going to be dealing with the Open Meetings Compliance Board complaint about not public review of the.
So perhaps we should change the word complaint to lawsuit?
Well, at the time, it doesn't make a difference, because at the time, you were served with a complaint.
Right.
That's what he gave you. He said, this is a complaint that's been filed in the circuit court. And that's why Councilman Bigliotti made the motion. He made the motion to deal with outside counsel and have the mayor deal with the complaint that was handed to you.
Right. So, Mr. Gullo, are you saying that the council was served with the paperwork about the Open Meetings Compliance Board procedure that's underway?
That's filed? That's not what I said at all.
So which
they're unrelated.
Well, one is related to the failure to allow public access to the counting of the petitions.
Right.
The second is related to the denial of citizens' access to a meeting because it was a secret meeting.
It's easy. The lawsuit was filed by your wife. That's the one that we're dealing with outside counsel. So you can remember it that way.
Did you mean, in your opinion, it was a secret meeting? Is that what you meant to say?
No, I was. It's a meeting. Nobody was allowed in. We were turned away at the door. People, citizens approached me about it.
I thought you were in Africa.
Yeah.
I was in Africa, and I wasn't notified of the meeting.
Well, you weren't invited.
Yeah, I wasn't invited to a meeting, and then I wasn't notified.
All right, well, let's move on. We've talked about that before, too.
There wouldn't be such meetings.
All right, now, anybody else have anything to say about the minutes besides Councilman Frazier? All right, now I'll ask the public if they have any comments on items that are not on the agenda for this evening. 2 minutes.
Catherine Adelaide, 9 Cortland. Can you hear me? I guess a news flash for some council members is that each time you hold a meeting, he has a right to say something. So if he wants to say something about the minutes, every single time you have a public meeting.
You think you'd get the message, don't you?
No, I would think you would get the message.
I would say that he spoke. His points were made.
Right.
And we moved on.
And if he thinks the minutes need to be tweaked a little for the average citizen to understand what's going on in the city, he shouldn't get all the, you know, CRAP that he gets from you guys. Just if he thinks something's wrong with the minutes, he's only asking to add a line to it. And I can see there was a complaint filed by myself, and then there was a lawsuit filed. So it's misleading, and the average person reading it wouldn't understand. I just don't understand why it's such a problem for you when he's doing his job. But actually, what I want to talk about that's not on agenda is the referendum petition. There is a pending Open Meetings Act violation with the Attorney General's office, and I'm concerned with why you wanted to rush it through so quickly, and you didn't want to wait until the Attorney General had issued an opinion about whether the legislative body should have determined the signatures. Again, this local government article, it says, if the petition, this is 4304D5, if the petition complies with this section, which refers to 4304D4 above it, there are two parts to that section. The petition has no effect if it's signed by less than 20%. It complied even according if it was done incorrectly. If it was done by staff and not you, according to them, it complied. Everybody agreed it complied. Okay, so it met that part. But the part it didn't meet was on receiving the petition, the legislative body, not the staff, shall verify that each individual who signed the petition is a qualified voter. That's the part that's in dispute. Hasn't been 2 minutes.
Let her finish.
Time's up.
Mr. Mayor, okay. Please let her finish. I'd like to hear what
All
she
right,
has
go
to
ahead.
Say.
Oh,
a couple
thank
more
you.
Minutes. A couple more seconds, rather, not minutes.
Okay, so that's the first part. It doesn't comply because it didn't meet Section 1. Then it goes on to say the legislative body, that's you guys. A legislative body means you make law. So all this scoffing at a councilman for reading the black letter law should not be going on. You are legislators. You're making law. Even the resolution eventually is going to create a charter amendment, which is the law. So a resolution is very close to an ordinance in this case, which is why 4304D5 says the legislative body shall specify by resolution, you got that part right, you're calling it a resolution that you just passed, is adopted in accordance with its normal legislative procedure. That's what takes us back to the charter amendment, which says the word ordinance. Legislative procedure is something that makes law. That's why it's correct to go back to your charter. The sad part is, had you followed this exactly, you could have introduced it tonight. I do appreciate very much that you gave the public a right to speak or the opportunity to speak before you made your decision. That just makes so much sense, and I thank you for that. But had you followed this exactly, I would have no complaint about it. You could have adopted this on Tuesday, which gave you the 6 days. Normally on Monday, you really can't. But this particular resolution does create law in the end. It changes the charter, which is the Constitution. That's why this local government article said it just that way, because it's not just some other resolution that you pass. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you for your opinion.
Any questions?
Anyone else?
I wanted to ask a question about the budget conversation. Can I do that now, or?
The what conversation? I'm sorry. I can't hear you. You're not at the mic. I can't hear until you get at the mic.
I wanted to ask a question about the audit conversation. And so Bobby Joe is here, and I didn't know if she'd be here at the end. So it's kind of on the agenda, but is that all right if I ask a question of Bobby Joe?
It's on the agenda or not on
the
agenda?
Yeah, I mean, it was, but.
Mr. Mayor, I think she should be allowed to ask it. That way Bobby Joe can leave as she sees fit.
All right, go ahead.
I didn't get to see it, so I'm just taking notes as y'all are talking, and it's a little bit vague. But I thought I heard that actual revenues were up compared to projections. And the numbers that I wrote down were $244,000 plus and $345,000 plus, which is a total of about $599,000. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Is that Michelle's presentation?
Mm-hmm. And then we ended up with a number of 133,000, which you mentioned. Where did the $466,000 go? The difference between those two, unless I'm not understanding where the. I thought I heard two numbers that added up to $599,000 in additional revenues that you weren't expecting. But then we got down to 133,000, so I was just wondering where the difference went. And I mean, I get maybe it was spent somewhere, but I was just wondering where. So, $344,096 is what I wrote down. I forgot the whole thing. And I thought they were comparing a projected revenue number with an actual, and it was greater. Right, and then I added to that a $345,000 number.
The expenditures were less $344,000.
We're gonna have to speed this up.
552, that number.
The net, and the net is the 133.
So between those two numbers. So what I was thinking she said was that the expenditures were greater than the amount that was actually spent.
Were
less, which means there would be more revenue. If you were projecting an expense to be, and it was greater than what you actually expended, then that means you'd have more revenue.
Well, that's the variance. We're only calculating the variance. Those numbers that you have are the variance. So the total revenue variance was 244 more than budgeted, and the expenditure variance was 344 less than budgeted, which only gives us a net change of fund of 133.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Let's hear from someone else. Well, I'm gonna take any more comments, or Ferry.
I am Ferry Flickinger, 12 Banker Terrace. Don, I am addressing you. The last meeting, you twisted my words. When I said I did not want my tax money used, I don't mean for your suing the town. So please understand that I'm addressing you. And the second thing I have to say, I don't have any other council person up here being prompted.
Thank you. Anyone else have any comments for non-agenda items? All right, let's move on. Addressing the council, do you have any conflicts of interest that appear on the agenda tonight?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No.
By consensus, no. All right. For Monday night, or Tuesday night, I'm sorry, I keep saying Monday. We have introduction of Ordinance 27-2016, the fiscal year budget amendment, and Ordinance 28-2016, fiscal year 2017 budget amendment. We've just reviewed those. I don't know if there's any further discussion on that or not. And for adoption, Tuesday, we have Ordinance 26-2016, the amendment to the sign ordinance, and Resolution 2016-29, the water allocation for October. Anybody have any questions on either one of those? We've already talked about the sign ordinance.
Excuse me, did you need
City Manager's report. Henry, what do you have for us?
Oh,
wait a minute, I missed. We introduced
just the
16.
Just why do we have it in our packet?
Well, I haven't spoken about it. Do you need me to speak about it?
Do you want to talk about the 2017?
Yes. Do you need me to speak?
Yes. 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 I thought you did. I missed something. I guess.
Okay. So the ordinance is 28-2016, and you have three pieces of paper. The first is the summary. The second is the general fund budget amendment for FY17, and the second is the utility fund budget amendment for FY17. So after looking at the FY16 reallocation of the salaries, we took a look at the FY17 budget. And the only allocation right now due to salaries is moving a portion of the treasurer's salary back to the general fund, since there's been a reorganization and the city manager will cover the supervision of the water and sewer division and not the treasurer. Therefore, in FY17, we budgeted 50% to water and sewer. Now we're gonna reallocate and only budget 10% to water and sewer. So that's the main change in the finance area. In the IT department, for the expenditures, we're budgeting $10,000 that wasn't originally in your FY17 budget, and that's for the web redesign and implementation, which I believe you're all aware of that already. And next thing in streets, the capital project for the LED retrofit. We were not awarded that grant, so we're taking those expenditures out of the FY17 budget. The parks and recreation, we're increasing by $43,800, and that's for the park sign, the electronic sign. So since we didn't do it in FY16, we have to now budget it for FY17. So those are the expenditure side. On the revenues in the general fund, the IT grant, that's offset, 10,000 expenditures, 10,000 from a grant. On the streets, we're decreasing, of course, the grant, and we're decreasing 3,500 by budgeted use of fund, since we're not going to do that project. And then parks and recreation, by approving this amendment, then you're also approving to use park impact fees.
Thank you.
And then for the utility fund, that all has to do with salaries. So that is decreasing the utility fund by 15,000, or excuse me, 31,000. And then those funds will be moved over to the general fund. And that's it.
Questions for Bobby Joe?
I don't have a question for Bobby Joe, but I have a question for, I guess, Henry regarding that. What park impact fees? thought we had conversation where we don't do park impact fees, and we talked about adding them.
No, what we're doing is moving the funds for the sign from one year to the other.
Well, I understand, but it says here request to pay out of park impact fees. That's what I'm trying to find out.
We have a park impact fee fund.
Okay. I'm just trying to understand, because previously we said that we don't collect park impact fees.
Well, we're not collecting. That's an expenditure.
Yeah, we talked about this. The shorthand, everybody says park impact fees. It's a open space fee in lieu of.
Thank you. Okay.
That's the really
thing. That's
what
I'm trying to understand. That's what I'm saying. There is no park impact fee. I had straight in my head.
Right. And we said we wanted to talk about instituting a park impact fee, but we call it this. That's not really what it is.
Okay.
Open space fee in lieu of.
In lieu of. Thank you. That makes a lot more sense now to me.
All right. Anyone else? All right, now let's move into the city manager report. Henry, what do you have for us?
Well, I'm going to be brief with this. The first thing I want to talk about is, you know, as you saw in the budget here, you know, we have to make some changes to the time sheets as recording. So I'm in the process of changing that right now, and we will have it implemented within the 60-day time frame that talked about. In doing so, one of the things I guess I discovered as well, when we thought about who needs to do this, or, you know, on the IT department, Dan Dennis is implementing the water billing system, which is a fun too thing. So we've not ever been capturing his time in there. So this is going to, you know, at least, you know, make things a little bit more clear too. As far as that water billing system, we are currently in what's called parallel testing. We are running two systems at the same time. And the purpose of doing the parallel test is at the end of the test, you should be able to have the same results come out of both sides or both systems. So we're in that process right now. The website upgrade, the bid selections have been made, and we're in a process of waiting right now for the contractor to sign the document and return it to us. We're still working on a 25-year capital projects budget and the capital equipment budget. And that's it.
Questions for Henry on his report? Any questions on the departmental report? Reports, plural. I think I had something. I gotta find my note.
Are you talking about the bid for the playground equipment?
Playground bid. That's in there, but that wasn't it. Well, I can't find my note.
If you think about it, you can get with me tomorrow.
I guess I'll have to bring it up Monday if I remember it.
Tuesday.
You can bring it up tomorrow.
Tuesday. I can't even remember when the meeting is, much less my note. All right. Let's move into the legal report. Counselor.
Okay. Mayor and Council, I have a few things. We'll start with what's on the docket there, which is the Ethics Commission report. The Taneytown Ethics Commission met last week with a couple items on their agenda. The first item was to adopt the campaign's finance forms. They had a prior meeting a month or so, 6 weeks before that, where draft campaign finance forms were submitted to them, and they needed to review them and make any changes. So at last meeting, they suggested their changes, and they adopted those forms. So those are now in effect, and to put it in perspective for everyone is that as you realize, the city passed the campaign finance ordinance that basically said candidates, political action groups, and individuals that spend a certain amount of money have to report their revenues and expenditures if they raise money, and there's lots of different thresholds in there. And the forms that you do to report those had to be drafted by the Ethics Commission, and so those are the forms I'm talking about. Everybody seems to confuse, so I want to make clear is that the Ethics Commission reviews the campaign finance reports, and they also review the financial disclosure forms, which is what's required under the city's ethics law, not the campaign finance law. So now those are forms are in effect, so for any further things, that's what will be done. We're gonna need to put those forms up on the website. We're gonna have them available at City Hall already, and you can find out the provisions of the city campaign finance law on the website or at City Hall if you have any questions. So that's a done deal. If you want copies of them, you can contact the city clerk and you can get copies of them, but that's effective now. Any questions on that?
Out of curiosity, has there been any discussion of providing a summary of the campaign finance law to make it a little easier for some to understand when they need to adhere to it?
There hasn't been yet, but okay. If you guys so direct, there could be some sort of pamphlet type thing that could be handed out.
Cliff's notes, something that in plain English will help them understand.
I like that idea.
So okay. We can come up with that. That's probably something that you all can review because the forms are pretty self-explanatory. They're easy to understand, but to whether you need to fill out the forms, you have to read the ordinance. So.
Right.
Okay, that's something we'll look into. The next thing that the Ethics Commission talked about was suggesting to you all election changes. And we talked about this a year ago, we talked about it this past summer, and now the rubber is gonna time to meet the road. So this is a little involved, but if you'll follow me, we can use this coming election as an example. Election day is set in the charter. This year it's May 1st, okay? So everything is derived backwards from that day. The time that you have to notify, the time that you have to register, the time that you put notices in the paper. Everything is done from that day there. Right now, the city, several years ago, the city passed an ordinance that codified certain provisions because every election cycle, it was a question, well, when is this gonna happen and when should we have that happen? So the city codified in section 103 of the city code a schedule. And that schedule basically says that from the election day, you basically count backwards and you have 7 weeks notice, meaning the ad in the paper saying we're having an election, these are the seats that are available, happen 7 weeks prior to election day. 4 weeks prior to election day is the nominations when they close. And then in between that times, there's different issues that go on with absentee ballots and with registration and things like that. At the last election, we had an issue that came up that put everybody in a bind in the fact that at the end of the candidate election time, there needs to be a review of the financial disclosure forms, not the campaign finance, that's new, the financial disclosure forms. And that is a new requirement was at the last election because prior to the institution of the state law on the subject, candidates didn't have to fill that out. Only elected officials that were already elected. And so the law said at that time, candidates have to fill out this form. That form has to be reviewed by the Ethics Commission. Well, the Ethics Commission is a volunteer board. They get together very infrequently. And the issue came after the candidate filed his forms or her forms and said, here, I'm a candidate. Then it takes a time to be reviewed. And the longer the Ethics Commission takes to review those forms to saying, we think they're incomplete or they're okay, the longer the candidate's status is in limbo. Are they a candidate or are they not a candidate? Because if they didn't fill out the forms at all, they can't be a candidate. And that created a problem that put us with complaints that we received as the city, put us right up to the point where the election was looming and there was an issue of whether or not the forms had been completed properly. We want to avoid that. We said that last year, we said that since that time, and the Ethics Board says they want to avoid it too. And their solution is this. They want to amend the time periods that are involved. Instead of having candidates file 4 weeks prior to the election, they want to make it 5 weeks prior to the election. And they want that basically to say the deadline for filing to run for office is 5 weeks prior to election day, but the deadline to be a verified candidate is 4 weeks prior to election day. So in that 1 week period, the election board realizes they have to meet. They have the opportunity to call the candidate up and say, we don't understand what's in your form, you need to provide more information, whatever it is. There's that week of back and forth to do that. And then by the end of that time period, if the information has been provided, they're a verified candidate, they're a certified candidate, if you will. If people have objections to that, that would be the time period of when complaints could be filed and moved on, still well a month prior to the election. So that's what they suggest. That's really the only change that needs to happen, is moving from 5 weeks to, or 4 weeks to 5 weeks, and then putting the verification date at 4 weeks. That's what they suggest should happen. The only other issue that they said could happen is if you want to keep the same spacing, right? The election notice went in 7 weeks prior, and the deadline was 4 weeks prior, so that was 3 weeks. They said if you want to keep that 3 week spacing, then put the notice in the paper 8 weeks prior, then you have the deadline 5 weeks prior, the verification 4 weeks prior, and everything else follows normally. Just to give you an example, this year the election's on May 1st. 4 weeks prior to that would be April 3rd, okay, which is the current deadline. You would basically make it 1 week prior to that, which would be the end of March. The advertising deadline is March 17th. It could be a week prior to that, which would be around March 10th. You don't have to change the charter to do any of this. You just need to amend the code, and we need to pass a resolution to do that. If you're comfortable with this direction, my suggestion is that we prepare an ordinance for introduction in the November meeting, and then you can discuss it and vote on it at December's meeting. Obviously, if you drag this closer to the time period, it creates a lot of hassle because of the advertising and things. Any questions about what they're talking about? Okay. You can direct me on Monday night whether you want me to do that and move forward on that. The last issue the ethics boards dealt with was a review of the quarterly ethics forms. As you know, the ethics board wanted all the elected officials and appointed officials that have to fill out the financial disclosure form to file quarterly report forms stating that nothing has changed, or if something has changed, fill out a new form. So those forms went out and they came back in. The ethics board reviewed them. Everyone that filed them, they found were everybody signed it saying nothing changed, except there were two forms outstanding. So we haven't received two individuals' forms. The deadline was last Friday. Contact has been made initially with an email on August 17th saying you got to fill out the forms. You all got that, you know that. And then the follow-up email to the delinquent people were sent on September 26th saying you really need to file these forms, and it hasn't happened. So the ethics board is leaving it in your hands of what to do about that.
Two people didn't file, that's what you said.
Two people.
Well, if they didn't file, they probably don't want the job.
So.
Did you all have a regional, a municipal meeting?
Sorry?
Like all the town mayors meet together? Last Thursday, wasn't it, last Thursday?
Did the town mayors do what?
You have regional meetings of.
Yes.
Yeah, I did get an email traffic on that.
Chapter meetings, is that what
chapter you're meeting, yeah. I've not been getting any of those emails. So I wasn't invited to that meeting. I like to go to those meetings. I didn't get any notification.
Didn't get a notice for this last happened? Chapter meeting.
I just don't know who these people are. You didn't notify them, or you did notify them?
One of them is you.
We not send everybody.
No, I didn't get any emails about this chapter meeting, and I heard about it after it was over.
I know it was announced.
I'm getting no email traffic from the town in the last.
Wait, what are we talking about, a chapter
meeting?
Okay, because I'm not getting any town. In the last 4 weeks, I've gotten no emails from the town at all.
Okay.
And I don't know why.
Well, I'm not sure that's on the subject that we're talking about.
Okay, well, if I'm one of them, he just said so. I'm not getting any town emails. We had an argument. Mr. Dennis, about whether he could have control of my computer in order to install my email, and I won't allow him to have control of my computer.
I don't know any about that. That's not really what the ethics board is.
Well, I've not
saying.
Been notified of any trouble because I'm not getting any email traffic from the town.
Well, I would certainly investigate that and make sure that
y'all know my email address.
Frazier's
well,
on the,
I mean,
on the
list ethics
to
board
get email.
Basically said
Taneytown record.
Okay, I understand you said you didn't get an email. That's fine. You need to fill out this form. But you've been at every council meeting when we talked about these forms that had to be filled out. I even gave a copy out at the forums at one of the meetings.
You just said that you two emails you didn't get any response to. My email address is in the Taneytown record. I didn't get any of those emails.
Okay, so you need to file this form. You didn't get the email. I'm not involved in that part of it. But
you're not?
No, I didn't send you emails.
Who sent these emails to me?
The city office sent these things.
Okay, I'm not getting any. But last 4 weeks, for some reason, it's grown very silent.
But you all saw this form because we handed it out 2 months ago at the council meeting, and you knew you had to fill it out. So you need to fill this form out. The other individual, he actually got a letter, because we don't have email for him. He got a letter that stated he needed to fill out the form, and he hasn't filled out the form. He's the chairman of the Board of Zoning Appeals. So.
All right, well, that's peculiar. I think we need to try to see if we can get Dan to figure out what's happening there if he's not getting emails.
I will check with him.
That's peculiar.
So in regard to the other person,
Mr. Hand,
can we make a phone call somebody to verify?
Yeah, I mean,
the blue sign in front of Gore headquarters got my cell phone number on it too. Everybody in town can see that.
Well, you're here at the meeting when we talk about it, so I figured you'd know from that. But again, right. So the issue that we have is there's two individuals that haven't done it. What effort do you want us to make? The Ethics Board says there was a deadline. It's not that big of a deal in the scheme of things because it was the quarterly update.
State have any suggested action?
No, this is beyond the state. This is what Pastor Orndorff of the Ethics Board, it was his suggestion to bring this forward to have you all do this. This is in addition to what you normally have to do.
I think we need to contact these individuals by phone and find out whether it was just something that was missed or were they intend not to send it in.
Right.
If they intend not to send it in, then they should be removed from whatever commission they're on.
Right.
If they said, I forgot, maybe we can give them a break.
So Clara, we'll contact them by phone to fill out the form. So that is it with the Ethics Commission report. That was their issue. They realized that by suggesting the changes, and they realized by the campaign finance rules that are coming into play, that they are going to need to meet on a regular basis. What they have stated that they don't want to happen, and they're not going to let happen, is they don't want it to be an individual from the Ethics Board making decisions. And that happened last time because, I'll give you the example, they met at a meeting, let's say at 7 o'clock on a Monday night, and they said this needed to be decided tomorrow because the deadline was on Wednesday, and they said, well, we can't make it as a board tomorrow at 11. But you, Mr. Chairman, you can go do it. And so at that point in time, it was Pastor Orndorff, it was also Chairman Ott. They became a one-person decider, and they said they're very uncomfortable with that. So what they decided they're going to do is in January, they're going to take the campaign finance filing dates, the candidate filing dates for the financial disclosure forms, and they're going to set Ethics Commission meeting dates in advance. So that's when they meet. And the candidates and everybody are going to know when those dates are. So if you dilly-dally and don't provide things by the review dates, they're going to take that into account because they just can't continue to meet every day during that cycle. Okay, I'm going to get off of the Ethics Board and switch to development issues, if there's no other questions on that. We have had great success, you've seen in the audit, you've seen in what's going on out on the ground with the Meadowbrook development. Their Section 4A has been put in the ground, they're selling some houses out there, not at the rate I'm sure they like, but they're selling some houses out there. And when we, the city and the Planning Commission approved 4A, they also approved a phase of that, which would be 4B. So it's already received all the necessary Planning Commission approvals. All that has to happen is the administrative side, which is the posting of the letters of credit and the adoption of a public works agreement. The developer usually doesn't want to start a new section until the first section is underway. But Dick Hall, who is the developer of that, believes that he has a market for that at this point and would like to start construction of 4B this winter, putting the pipes in the ground, doing the things. The mass grading and stormwater has all been done. That's what he did last winter, which allowed him to build this summer. So he basically said he's doubling down and wanting to do that. So what he needs from us to make this happen, to keep the growth going and things like that, is an adoption of a public works agreement. The issue that we have is and the way we have done this in the past is the staff has usually negotiated the public works agreement, adopted it, and you have ratified it, and that was the policy. This way, we're going to turn this around a little bit. We need to ratify going to a public works agreement so that we can do it this month, and he can go ahead and start the process at the county to get his plats recorded, and then you can come back next month and ratify what was done, if that's what you're saying. Here's the easy part. It's going to be the same as the public works agreement you already adopted. The only thing that's different, we're going to take out the stuff that dealt with mass grading and stormwater, because that wasn't in there, and we're going to adjust the numbers that are in the letter of credit. Those numbers are reviewed by the Public Works Department and the city engineer, so you know that's they are what they are. So if you're okay with that, I'm going to put on the agenda for Monday on new business adoption of the 4B Public Works Agreement for Meadowbrook. I can give you a draft copy if you'd like me to put, you know, a 20-page document in your pile on Monday so that you can see what it is, or we can wait until all the numbers are filled out. But in the end, it is what it is. So it's your direction. You tell me what you want me to do on that.
Would you recommend waiting for the numbers or giving us the information ahead of time so that we're at least aware of the general idea of things?
I mean, I would recommend that if you just see the draft numbers with the draft document with the blanks, then you know what you're agreeing to. The numbers are, if we told you it was $14,100 or $15,200, it's going to be whatever the recommendation is made. So those things are kind of irrelevant.
All right, could we have those for Monday night then?
I'll get you the draft documents. It'll have blanks. You'll have it on Monday night. You'll vote on that, and then the staff will go ahead and execute it this month.
Thank you.
So that'll keep the development moving, and I don't remember how many more houses that is, but it's 25 to 35 more houses that are going to be in the queue. And that's important for us to realize in the scheme of things is that there really aren't any more ready to go. Okay, I mean, we've been talking with Meads Crossing. They haven't recorded theirs yet, so they're going to miss this cycle. Creekside's done. Carroll Vista has 2, 3, 4, none. I mean, that many. There aren't any more lots getting ready to be developed. So at some point in time, the new money is going to come out. Is not going to come in anymore. And that's one of the things that we probably need to address when we're talking about the Vigliotti policy, because unless you have the developers recording stuff now, you won't have the impact fees to pay us back for the debt that we already have, if that made sense. So we're getting to a critical phase of that.
Has Meadowbrook made any mention of ultimately phases 5 and 6? I remember originally there were phases 5 and 6.
Oh, they're going to do them, but they want to see the success on 4A and 4B.
Right.
So if you had to guess, and this is just my guess, if it takes a year to do a phase, is what he's talking about, you're probably talking 2 to 3 years out for the next, because those haven't gone through Planning Commission review yet.
Right.
All right,
so that gives you a summary of that, and that's all I have under my report.
Questions for Jay? I remembered what I forgot on the departmental reports. The planning and zoning report lists that we issued a zoning certificate for construction of a 2,600-foot penthouse at 5151 Allendale Lane. I'm not sure we've ever had a penthouse in Taneytown. but the bigger question is, I think this is industrial land, and how can we have a residential development in industrial land? So I don't understand that.
Have to look at that.
I think the homes that are there were grandfathered in.
I'm sorry?
I think the homes that were there were grandfathered in. I didn't know that we allowed residential development in industrial land.
Well, I know there's portions down there that are R6000. I need to pull up a zoning map and actually look at it.
What is 5151?
Where is it?
on Allendale Lane.
Thanks for that.
I know that.
Here, let me pull it up.
I bet it's something like Tawny's Dare.
I have no clue about what this is about because it's not my department, but I can tell you it is probably not residential, because if it were, it would be reflected in your water allocation resolution, because they would have had to have had a water allocation for a new residence.
Well, can we just find out about that and fill us in on Monday night? I just, Mike, Tuesday night, I'll get it right. All right. Old business, anyone have any old business? And we have new business, anybody have any, first of all, the monthly financial report is in your packet. Does anyone have any questions on the monthly financial report? Hearing nothing, that'll be up for approval on Tuesday. I got it right this time. Next is the accounts payable. Anybody have any questions on the accounts payable? That'll be up for approval on Tuesday also. Before we entertain public comment pertaining to agenda items, I'd like to mention a thing that Mayor Roop from New Windsor brought to my attention at the latest chapter meeting in Manchester a couple weeks ago. Apparently, New Windsor has a shadowing program that they were working with Elmer Wolf Middle School on. And since their middle school closed, the teacher has transferred to Taneytown, and they're continuing that mentoring program from students in the New Windsor area that have come up, and we've been invited to participate too. In other words, a shadowing program. And I think it might be very interesting and very rewarding. I know that I've been involved in these things on a couple of occasions, and they've always been very fulfilling. I don't have the details. I just got the acknowledgement yesterday, and I'm waiting for things to sift out. But I kind of thought that y'all ought to give that some thought and see if you'd want to participate. And I'll try to have the details Tuesday, and we'll talk about it.
Okay. Fair.
Now, I'd entertain public comment pertaining.
Just to give you a little bit of fill in on that, what they do at the school, from what I gather, is there's a mock election. And the council members are voted, the mayor's voted, and they basically fill in, somebody will take my spot, and somebody will take his spot, and they actually run the meeting. And that YouTube clip that they sent us pretty much details that, shows you a little bit.
Well, it's something that New Windsor's been participating in for some time. I don't know whether they were doing that when you were there or not, Jay. But
yeah, I think we did it with the middle school.
Mm-hmm. But it could be a good way to help the kids learn, and I'll try to get the details. And bring
5150 is a VAPCO, by the way.
Is what?
VAPCO?
Yeah, 5150 is a VAPCO for your penthouse, so that we'll find out why they're putting a penthouse in, but that's what we're talking about.
Isn't this 5151 on?
I mean, that's what I mean. 50. Okay. I was doing Van Halen. Sorry.
I'm just very curious about that. That's all.
Yeah, that's 5151.
All righty.
That's a VAPCO.
That's a VAPCO, he says.
Okay.
Public comment pertaining to agenda items. Anybody have any comments from the audience on items that have appeared on the agenda tonight? 2 minutes.
Clarify Robin's for Robin.
Okay. You got the answer.
Yes.
Okay.
So back to Robin's question. So the expenditures and the revenue, yes, the between the two, it's $588,000. then we take out our budgeted use of funds that we did not use of $455,000, and that's where we get the $133,000.
The $455,000 is what again?
We in FY16 we budgeted that we were going to have to use fund balance to balance the budget of $455,000, and we didn't have to. So once we take our revenue and our expenditures, that excess deficiency and under in expenditures is the 588 number. And then we subtract out the fund balance that we didn't use of 455. And that's how we get the net change of the 133.
Okay, so the 455 basically stayed in the savings account, is what you're telling me?
Yes, correct. Okay.
Thank you.
Catherine Adelaide, 9 Cortland. Just regarding the campaign finance subject, I guess my first comment is, if it's so complicated you can't understand it, I don't think it should have been passed. That's my first comment. Secondly, my overall objection to the campaign finance was that it appeared to me at least to be part of a legislation along with the charter amendment and the code of conduct that was put together to target Councilman Frazier. And I think the code of conduct is unconstitutional, and so unless you have a criminal conviction from a court of law, be aware, because it may be challenged again in court. So overall, I thought it was part of a bullying, retaliatory effort against Councilman Frazier for trying to lower water rates and lower taxes. That's just my opinion. The second reason I had trouble with it was that I think it will discourage people from running for public office here. So I really did like Councilman Wance's idea of a summary to help other candidates, because as a citizen activist, I am encouraging lots of people to run for office. I want to see more citizens run for office, and I don't want to see them be discouraged. So I like the summary idea, but I would add, when you do the summary, because I'm a technocrat for the law, make sure you have the exact law with it also, because the little bit of a double bind you get into is that if somebody relies on the summary, I just encourage people to still try to read the law. But I like examples and how to apply it. You understand what I'm saying? Because that could get them in trouble. They think they're following a summary, and then they actually violated, because of their own misunderstanding, the actual part of the law. So I would include the actual law with your summary, but I like the summary with examples of how it actually plays out. I think that's great. And my third comment would be, I guess maybe for Mr. Gullo, the Ethics Commission, I like that they have moved the 4 weeks and the 5 weeks. My question is if they file an ethics violation and the ethics board clears the violation, the proper venue is the circuit court. And so I would have a concern that only having a week might not accomplish the result, which I think was a good one. That
you would need to wrap up.
Okay. Did you understand the my concern, though? That because if someone files an ethics violation and they're cleared, the proper venue is circuit court. I'm not sure that would all be resolved in the one extra week. It's just something to think about. But I like the general direction of trying to move everything back so that there's more time to sort out these sort of things.
Thank you. Anyone else? Jackie?
As I said earlier, I'm Jackie Jones. I'm not sure where my comes in, but it's this. Mr. Mayor and council members, I suggest, and I'd appreciate, if only one person of you speaks at a time. I think now mine comes under common courtesy, not whether it's agendas or what, but one person at a time. When one speaks over the other, it's hard hearing back here. I grant you, I have a hearing aid, but that even confuses it more when you have more than one person speaking, and I think those of you who have hearing aids understand that. We can't help it, we're that old. We were born when we were born. But the other thing is, I'm kind of confused when I have these armchair lawyers get up and speak about the law. I'm not questioning whether you can read the law or understand it, but I think that we have a lawyer here who was very capable of answering our questions without having additional confusions. Now, we're pretty smart, maybe some of us aren't smart, but I will tell you this, it would be very appreciative if we won, and the more complaints we have, and I must say, Don, this is pick on you tonight, but here's something I have to say. I think you've got what my husband has sometimes, selective hearing. Because I talk to him and he'll say, I didn't hear that. But so talk over one another. It's very difficult.
Jackie,
thank you.
I just think process matters. This petition type things, they, if we violate the procedures now, for generations ahead, the precedent will be set. That's the only reason I bring it up. I just want the process to be following the law.
Well, I know a little bit about Robert's rules, and I don't think we're following them here. Not everybody. Some of you are, but some
Barbara's
of you aren't.
Barbara's giving me good advice. She says, I always get the mayor's permission before you speak.
Thank you, that's Jackie. Anyone else care to make a comment? Robin.
Hello again, Robin Fraser. I just wanted to say, and I've mentioned this before, that Comptroller Rob Burke is an expert on water and sewer rates. The county doesn't hire anyone to do that. At least they hadn't in the when I've been there. And they set the rates, the water and sewer rates. They figure out the how the capital expenditures match up with your bonds and so forth, and when your debt gets paid off. So you pay off something before you do a capital project because it kind of balances out. And he told me when I was asking questions and clarifying some things that he would be happy to come and talk to you all about figuring out your rates if you would ask him. So I want to say that again, that you might ask Comptroller Burke, who is an expert, and the, like I said, the county doesn't pay anybody to do that. They figure out the rates themselves. He would
thank
be willing
much
to help you.
Thank you very much.
May I address that for a second? We have contacted or attempted to, and Mr. Burke is not available to help us.
Okay. Anyone else make a comment?
Well,
the bottom line is this. Our consultants began this process, gave us good advice, put us on a pathway to financial solvency after these state mandates, unfunded mandates, and we've realized the goals that they have set for us. So it would only be logical to continue this and see if there's ways that we can improve efficiencies further, and perhaps one day look at adjusting these rates down. And that's why I think the continuity is important between our current, to have our current consultant continue on this process, because they're familiar with this from the very beginning. Now, does anyone else have any comments? Hearing nothing, can I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed like sign. So Gary.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.